Thank you for joining us today. We're going to get started in just a little bit, but if you could just please find your chat box and make sure all your settings are listed for all panelists and attendees as we get ready to start our webinar, that would be great. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Yes, She Can Alumni Webinar, Projects for the Empowerment of Girls and Women. My name is Hannah, and I am the YES Program Coordinator at Iron USA.
And I'm Gloria, and I am the YES Program Manager at Iron USA. So today, the Yes, She Can Projects for Empowerment for Girls and Women will be a YES webinar serving as a guide for alumni, on-program students, and organizations to effectively organize projects and activities pertaining to the advancement of girls all around the globe.
After you watch this webinar, you should learn how to execute projects, activities, and events, empowering girls and women as a member of the YES community in correlation with International Day of the Girl, which is October 11th. Get insight into inspirational projects and activities YES alumni have accomplished in the past, and you should be able to learn more about the United Nations Sustainable Development Goal number 5, achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls.
So everyone, we see the chat is going on. Everyone, if you want to make sure that your chat box is set to all panelists and attendees so everyone can see what you're saying. And we see that a lot of people are sharing where they're from. So if you could just talk a little bit about what country you're viewing from so we can get a little sense of that.
So we're going to go ahead and launch this poll. How confident are you now in your ability to lead or focus on gender equality? So if you are confident right now, before we start the webinar, we just want to know how confident you are in your ability to lead a project-focused projects on gender equality, just so we can get an idea of where you are with planning projects for International Day of the Girl.
All right, we see everybody's sharing where they're from. They're also filling out this poll. Wow, we have a lot of people that are feeling pretty confident.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Great. So, Hannah, I'm going to be a little bit honest with you. I don't really know what you're talking about exactly when you mean United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. What are they and why are there so many?
That's a great question, Gloria. Yeah. In January 2016, leaders from all over the world came together to implement 17 goals that would act as a plan of action for people, the planet, and prosperity. The goals are known as the SDGs. I'm sure maybe a lot of our viewers know about the SDGs, but they stand for the Sustainable Development Goals. Some call it global goals, and they are a collaborative effort from all over, United Nations, partners from the United Nations, organizations like the YES program. There are so many nonprofit organizations that have come together in a collaborative effort to fulfill these goals. And it also serves as a guide for global development until the year 2030. So today, in celebration of International Day of the Girl, we'll be focusing on SDG number 5, gender equality.
That's really awesome. I mean, I feel like with all the great work that our YES alumni have been doing, you know, achieving these goals by 2030 is really not a problem.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Too easy. Yeah. But before we begin, we're going to go over again some of the features in the room that will help you navigate and participate and really engage with all of the other students that are joining us in the webinar today. we have some chat settings. If you could look at the bottom right of your chat settings, make sure that is checked to all panelists and attendees. So everyone is getting a chance to see what you're saying and where you're from, not just us. For example, I see we have Maxim and Garmay joining and Diota from Indonesia. And those chats came just to me and Hannah, but I feel like everyone.
Yeah.
Should get a chance to see what you're saying. So make sure that's checked. We are, as you noticed, going to have some polls going on throughout the webinar so that you can share your knowledge, some thoughts, and where you feel about your knowledge in regards to the SDG. Also, we are on Facebook Live. Yes. Those of you who are watching and joining us from Facebook Live, please feel free to also add your questions and comments on there, because we are definitely looking out for those. Lastly, we are recording this webinar. So if you miss something, you just want to watch it again, or your friend is asking what you've been doing this morning, evening, afternoon, you can send them the link and you'll see it on the YES Programs website or on the YouTube page.
Awesome. And if you are following us right now on Facebook, please, I think Gloria said this already, please go ahead and share this live with your friends so that way they can see it as well and join in. Gloria, is that all the house rules we have?
I think so. I think that's it. If anyone has any questions or has trouble hearing us, please leave a comment.
Fine. SDG number 5 is all about gender equality and all about empowering women and girls all over the world. And we know that a lot of YES alumni have been doing that from all parts of the world. So we encourage you to go on the United Nations website, UN Women, UNICEF, so many organizations that are doing great things to empower girls as far as entrepreneurial endeavors. What other things are people doing around the world for SDG 5? I think we saw a couple of menstruation hygiene products that were getting donated to girls, which I won't say too much because that's one of our alumni guests, but I think we can even get into our alumni speakers now.
Yeah, I'm excited.
I'm excited.
I feel like they're a lot more interesting than you and I probably.
Yeah, I think they are.
Yeah.
They're amazing.
Great.
Yeah. So let's get right into it. We have our first panelist who is going to get ready to get queued up. Her name is Tasneem Kibria. She's from YES 2014. And she is the treasurer of YES Alumni Bangladesh. We have who's here from Bangladesh? We have a lot of alumni and people signing in.
Yay.
Yay, Tasneem. And she was the former shadow ambassador of Her Excellency Marcia Bernicat to promote young women's leadership, an initiative by the Dutch ambassador of Bangladesh. How amazing is that, right?
That's exciting. We have, oh, I see there are some fans.
We have a lot of fans here.
In the chat room, okay.
As a member of YES Alumni Bangladesh, Tasneem has helped organize and implement alumni projects for the advancement of girls, such as 3.5 billion reasons and self-defense 101. Now, are you ready to meet Tasneem?
I am very ready.
I'm ready. So now we're going to have Tasneem come up. Hi.
Hello, everyone.
Tasneem, whenever you're ready to present, you can go ahead. We're going to go away.
Okay. Oh, there's a lot of people. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining us. My name is Tasneem Kibria Orpa, and I'm from YES 14 batch. I was placed in Houston, Texas. Currently, I'm studying in Independent University of Bangladesh, doing my bachelor's. Before I start, I would like to put up a few questions for the participants here. First of all, what would you do if you were denied the right to a proper education? How would it feel if you were stripped away from your basic rights? So even in a strictly patriarchal country like Bangladesh, this country has made significant progress in Millennium Development Goals and other indicators in terms of providing opportunities for women. However, there is a huge gap between urban and rural female students in educational opportunities and leadership. A female student in Bangladesh is more likely to be a victim of child marriage, sexual assault, and dropping out of school. 3.5 billion reason addresses the gap of education and leadership opportunities. between urban women and rural female students in Bangladesh. The program 3.5 billion reasons seeks to close the gap in education and leadership opportunities by training a group of female students and equipping them with necessary tools to pursue higher education and create opportunities for other students. Here you can see a few pictures from our workshop. In this workshop, we brought in 18 female students from outside of Dhaka who were paired up in teams of three, one of them being a mentor. This summit was run by both YES Alumni Bangladesh and trained professionals in related fields. The mentors were young women who are pursuing higher education in the urban society. This workshop covered the following topics: identification of an issue in the community and how to draw a project outline around it, solution to various case studies brought in by students and how to tackle the barriers, ways to motivate the members to work hard without any financial barriers. Here, the students were presented with tipping points of unequal treatment towards women, the discourse that is required to combat stereotypes. In this project, we worked on making the students community ambassadors in their respective areas so that they can involve more youth to partake in leadership activities to create a ripple effect. We implemented our project in such a way that the students become the future leaders of tomorrow, and we are capable of carrying more projects to improve their community, to learn and exercise democratic principles in problem solving. The students were taught to grow interest in participating and organizing community service projects, to keep pursuing education and inspire others in local community through sustainable goals. I would also like to mention the fact that we did not bring this 18 students just to make leaders out of them, but to create, once again, a ripple effect so that they could contribute to our community, so that we could create a greater change, so that this was one of our sustainable projects. The project has four management skills, that is, can we go to the next slide, please? Planning, organizing, leading, and controlling. So you have to realize when you are implementing a project, you need a project proposal, you need the plan of the project, including the budget. One of the most important point that we emphasized on was social media outreach and content making. Here we tried to reach as many people as we can in Bangladesh through local newspaper and social media. Always remember, while you're leading a project, you have to communicate effectively. You have to motivate and inspire your team members. And most importantly, you will go wrong at one point or the other, but always remember to be patient, to evaluate your problems, and to take the necessary corrective actions towards your goal. I would also like to mention a few more projects that were done by YES Alumni Bangladesh. As Hannah said before, I was a shadow ambassador in 2016 to Madam Marcia Bernicat. With that, we also have another project that is the Self-Defense 101. Self-Defense 101 plans on giving everyone a fighting chance if they do unfortunately fall prey to an attack. This year, recently, we had another project called Project X, which is a workshop carried out by Ifrit Tahia, a YES Alumni member, to increase awareness on sexual education among families in Bangladesh and to promote safe sex practices. Through these projects, we are trying to empower women. We are trying to break away those stereotypes that the patriarchal society gives us. I would like everybody to stand up and take a stand for women empowerment, to start doing projects like this, and to make a change in our community, in this world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tasneem. That was amazing. Thank you for encouraging and empowering our alumni. You are an amazing young woman. What did you think of that, Gloria?
I think that's really awesome. You know, I have so many questions that I want to ask, you know, about the presentation, but I'm going to save them.
Okay.
Yeah. But again, she talked about, you know, the importance of empowering girls and women. And then she also touched on for how other students can start their own projects, right?
Right. And 3.5 billion reasons is actually a major hit in the YES Alumni world. reached so many alumni and so many people outside of the alumni community. So great job to Tasneem and to the entire YES Alumni Bangladesh community. And now we want to actually launch another poll. If you see here, it's gonna pop up right on your screen. Please go ahead and take that poll. Have you ever participated in a project focused on empowering girls and women? And we already see people answering. You all are so fast. We have a lot of yeses.
Wow, okay, so a lot of yeses, but we also have a lot of people who haven't yet, but it's on their radar. That's really great. A lot of no, but planning soon. That's.
We're so looking forward to seeing those projects that are being planned for Day of the Girl. And so we're gonna go on to our next guest speaker.
Yes. Our next guest speaker is Portia Akua Yeboah from YES 2017. She is from Ghana, and she is the founder of the Red Elephant Project, which provides feminine hygiene supplies to girls in Ghana. As part of this much-needed project in her community, Portia translates information pertaining to menstruation in her native language in order for girls to gain education pertaining to this topic. Portia also helps create sanitary kits for girls, which includes reusable sanitary pads and a guidebook to educate girls about menstruation.
That's awesome.
Yeah, this is a really big and really important topic that a lot of times I feel doesn't get the resources that it deserves.
Yeah, and we're so happy to have Portia with us. Portia, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
And she's here.
Hi, everybody. Okay, hi, everybody, and thanks for joining us today. We are so excited to be here. I am so excited. So once again, I'm Portia from Ghana, YES Alumni 2017. And during my exchange year, I was hosted in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and I had an amazing time there. So today I'm going to share with you a brief story about my project that I'm having for girls and how it's helping in the community. So without wasting time, let's go right to the Red Elephant Project. So what is the Red Elephant Project? This, the elephant in the room is an expression that applies to an obvious problem that nobody wants to discuss. So the Red Elephant Project was initiated by Hope Without Borders, an organization based in the US that is devoted to helping countries in terms of health, hygiene, and water supplies, things like that. So the Red Elephant Project is one of the projects that is organized by Hope Without Borders, which I am now also having in my country, Ghana. So what the Red Elephant Project does is we provide reusable or long-lasting sanitary materials for girls who can't afford to buy the normal disposable sanitary materials. And so each kit contains seven sanitary pads, that is seven liners with two protective shells, which holds the liners in place, and two pairs of underwears, a towel and a soap, and also a guidebook to teach the girls about their changing bodies and how to use these sanitary materials since it's reusable. So the story behind this project is how I got involved was, whilst I was on exchange in the US, I got the chance of meeting a lady, a doctor called Dr. Julie Carvey, who happens to be the medical director for Hope Without Borders. And upon meeting with her and hearing about the Red Elephant Project, it brought my mind to an issue back home in Ghana, which this could help solve. The problem was that girls in back home in Ghana, the rate of teenage pregnancy in my region in Ghana increases every year, which is a very which is nothing to write home about. And then also the lack of feminine hygiene among the girls. So upon meeting with Dr. Carvey, I got in touch with her and kept in touch to get some of these kids to start a project like the Red Elephant Project also in Ghana to also help the girls back home. So please the next slide. So the problem of lack of hygiene and also teenage pregnancy motivated me to get in touch with Dr. Palvi and then get some of these sanitary materials for the girls. So then what do I do? Since the sanitary kits are long lasting, if a girl maintains it well, it can last the girl for about 2 to 3 years, and it costs $10 for each kit. And so since it's reusable, the need to teach the girls how to use kits, it's very key in the Red Elephant Project. So what I do is to organize the girls and teach them how to use these sanitary materials and these products so that the girls are able to maintain feminine hygiene and also develop their morale or confidence to be outside, to be in public. Because since the girls in the community don't have such materials, they can't afford, they can't buy these disposable monthly, you know, sanitary materials. They use other means such as using a cloth, which might be dirty, which might be leaking, which are not good for their health. And so the Red Elephant Project seems to provide these materials for the girls who can't afford it. So when I returned in August 2017, I organized 20 girls, because when I was returning from the exchange program, I was able to get 20 of the sanitary kits from Hope Without Borders to come and start a project like this in my country. So upon selecting the 20 girls in my community who might be in need of these materials, I gathered them and then we had discussion about feminine hygiene and everything in the guidebook they need to know to maintain these materials clean and neat. So I met with the girl and they were so excited to have these materials and they were so grateful. So that is one thing that made me so happy about, you know, organizing this project and being with the girls, meeting them for the first time. It was amazing. So they practiced how to use the sanitary material themselves and they were so comfortable using it. So the reason why I had this project for the girls is because I am so passionate about it. I feel fulfilled after, you know, meeting with these girls and making sure I'm helping them in my own way, and it's helping their lives. It's helping some of them to stay in school, because some of them, due to, you know, leakages and things like that during their menstrual cycles, the week they have their menstrual periods, as I heard from some of them, they are not able to be in school, so they have to stay home until they are out of that period. And this is a natural thing that shouldn't keep any girl from, you know, going to school or having other rights and privileges to enjoy. But this preventing them to, you know, stay back and not have confidence in themselves and then stay out of social activities. So the passion I have for empowering girls and the passion I have for helping my community is what empowered me to keep in touch with Hope Without Borders, to volunteer with Hope Without Borders, and continue to provide such kits for the girls. So my goal now is to reach more girls in Ghana, not just in my region, because the rate of teenage pregnancy in the country increases every year, even though my region always have a higher percentage of the rate of cases recorded in teenage pregnancy. But then my goal is to reach a lot of girls in the country so as to have discussions about, you know, how to maintain feminine hygiene, how to reduce these cases of teenage pregnancies. When we talk about it, it can be done. So I met with these girls and we had all these things together. It was a fun day and it was a great day. And I had a lot of experiences. I had a lot of things from the girls, which is also giving me new ideas on how to help these girls, not only in providing sanitary materials, but also looking into their personal lives and having set conversations, which is going to build a bigger community of girls in my society. So this is something I want to share about the Red Elephant Project and what I do. Thank you all.
Thank you, Portia. That was really, really inspiring. I think the chat box is very lit up with people who are really touched by the work that you're doing for these girls. You're right, you know,
every month. This is a natural bodily function for these girls, and the fact that it prevents them from attaining such important things like education and staying healthy is very critical. And it's amazing that you are doing this work.
Exactly, and this is an issue too in countries around the world. Many girls miss out on days of school because they don't have these sanitary products. So you are doing great work, Portia. We hope that you continue to do that.
Yes. So now it's time for our panel Q&A. I'm sure everybody is bursting with questions that they want to ask Tasneem and Portia. So if you two ladies would like to come back on camera and turn your mics back on. And does anybody have any questions in the chat box? To begin, I want to ask, what inspired you to participate in each of your projects? Did you kind of have like a aha light bulb moment, or what made you feel that it was your duty to take the first step in creating these projects?
Okay, so to me, what inspired me was, you know, giving back to my community, because getting the chance, not everybody in my community in Ghana got the chance to be in the US to have a physical exchange like I had in the US. And so during my whole stay in the US as an exchange student, I felt it's a responsibility of coming, you know, building myself well and coming back to contribute to my community. So since I returned, I never had the feeling of, you know, staying idle and not doing anything, but also I feel obligated to, you know, be contributing to my community in a way I love to do it, in a way I have a passion for. So getting the chance to meet with Hope Without Borders was one of the good things that ever happened to me. And I'm always privileged to be on this platform to also let everybody know and to encourage girls. It's what motivated me, or what inspired me, was to give back, because a country gave to me, and I also feel like giving back in a way I enjoy doing it to help the community.
I would say that what inspired me is that every single day you have to wake up and you have to struggle your way through every single day. I do get on local buses and I see women struggle because of the patriarchal society and how men treats women in our country. At the end of the day, I do want equality for everyone, men and women both, even the transgenders. And given the coordinator of the project, Mustasin Islam, he was the one who started all of this, and it was actually an inspiration. He is an inspiration to me because he has been working for women for such a long time, and he's very dedicated. And I do want every single girl in this country and in this world to be educated, to have the opportunity to make a change, or to have the rights to their own life, the freedom to choose whichever life they choose. And giving them that, even trying to do that, is what actually inspired me to do this project.
That's awesome. We also have some great questions coming up in the chat box as well. We have a question asking, when YES alumni are considering organizing projects for girls and women, what are some important things that they need to consider that maybe they wouldn't have thought about if they were organizing a project that was for both genders or for just boys and men?
Okay, so I will talk about funding. You know, you need funds to run, in order to run a project. And so, for instance, my Red Elephant project, each kid costs $10 for a girl, and we need money to, you know, fund these to get more of the kids, because there were more than 20 girls who needed these materials, but then that was 20 was all we could provide. So, you know, getting funding for the project is a key thing. And also, what I'll talk about is, you know, identifying the right people, because some people can afford, for my case, some people can afford the material. So, you know, fishing out for the right people in the right environment to have such projects is also key in my Red Elephant project.
What I would like to say, the things that you should consider is, first of all, security. even if it is for men and women, or just men or women, you have to consider if it's a workshop that is 3 days long or 2 days, you have to think about the security, you have to think about the budget, whatever funds you get, you have to make it work. You have to look for sponsors. That is the most important thing, because there will be organizations and companies who would love to sponsor your project and provide you with resources that you need. Yeah, that's about it. And remember to have a core team and always keep it working and always communicate with one another.
That's great. That's really important.
Also on that, I would like to talk about teamwork. Sometimes you have to get people to work with, so that whenever you are not around, you get other people in charge to also take over, so the project doesn't come to a halt. Like, when you are not there, then that's the end of the project, which wouldn't help. So in a community like mine, you try to, you know, connect with other people who can also take charge when you are not around. And also, as Tasneem was saying, try to make, seek for sponsorships and try to connect with other people and organizations who might find interest in your project to also help.
That's awesome. Great. But are there any boys or men who participate in your projects? How do you get them to participate, and what is usually their role?
Portia, do you want to go first?
You can go first, Tasneem.
Okay. I would say that when it comes to projects like these, when you're working with women empowerment and women specifically, it really doesn't have to be women working all along. Like, the entire team doesn't have to be completely of women. You can bring in boys, because 3.5 billion reasons, the organizer, the coordinator, was composed of Mubashir Mone, Mustasin Islam, Prince. So they were all men. So whatever they did, they worked in logistics team, they worked in PR, some of them worked for photography and auditing, editing the videos. So there are works for other the other gender while you're working for a specific gender-based project.
Okay, so I would say yes, that some men are involved in my project. Like, on the day I had the Red Elephant project for the girls, I also invited a brother of mine who happens to be an eye specialist to also give, you know, eye screening, free eye screening for the town people, aside meeting with the girls. So it was like a joint project. We had, after meeting with the girls, also going with the girls as a group to join the eye screening project, and also we did it together. So sometimes you need the help of the boys in, you know, helping, putting things in place, raising stuff that might be heavy, and also getting them in there in a way to help in their own way.
I would also like to add one more thing. If you want to bring in boys or girls in a project where you think it's not appropriate, I don't think there is any project where it should be seen that way, but if it is, always ask around. You can always share your project ideas on Facebook and get feedback from other people, and you can invite people from your university, your school, your community. You can just talk to people and find whoever is willing to work with you.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's really important. I think a common misconception is that projects for girls and women can only be done by girls and women. But in reality, it should be gender equality for all, by all.
Well, we have a lot of alumni who are males doing projects for girls and women, specifically Tamba from Sierra Leone, and again, Mustu from Bangladesh. We have great alumni like those who are doing a lot of things for SDG 5. So you don't have to be female to empower female.
Great. Another question, a good one, is we have a student who is involved in a gender equality project in their school, but it's really hard to invite all the girls to come join us. So their question is, did your project go well from the very beginning? And if not, how do you get people, more people involved?
Firstly, it is very hard to find participants in the first place. But what we started doing is we started talking to the authority. We started approaching the schools. So we would go to the principal, we would give them the project proposal, we would ask them to participate, and we would ask them to assign one of their teachers from school to give us two or three students. Yes, it is very hard, especially when it comes to girls, or even any project where you want people to show up and you want an entire school to show up. It is very difficult to get that, but it's a challenge that you can take on, and you will be able to successfully complete it if you follow a few steps. That is, you can use different PR methods. You can use bulletin boards where you can stick in those brochures. You can give out leaflets to students and ask them to come over. You can ask the social media. You can ask your local newspaper to start producing more medias or producing more information on your project that you are doing. And you have to plan it at least 3 months ahead of time if you really want that big of a crowd. Portia?
So just as Tasneem was saying, normally you have to reach out to organizations like schools, churches, mosque, and so for my project we went to a church, and so we met with the priest of the church and made the necessary announcement 3 weeks earlier, because the project wasn't that big of a thing, even though it was really helping the community or impacting the whole community in a way. But then we met with the priest to make sure that the right people are selected for the project and the necessary announcements are made so that the people are there on the day for the project. Because if you organize a project and the people don't show up on the day of your project, it means, you know, all your plans are, you know, coming to be a mess. So you try to make the necessary announcements and remind people using posters, as Tasneem was saying, and other, you know, ways, depending on where you're having your project or the community you're having it, other means to reach your people, to, you know, deliver such information and get the right people through those institutions to get the people into the project that you want to have.
That's great. It sounds like, I think, preparing in advance early on is really important, connecting with those partnerships and establishing those ties that help you get people to participate. Those are some excellent tips.
Yeah, definitely.
We have another great question. I think this one is directed specifically for Tasneem. Did you find the girls to participate through an organization? How did you find someone to teach self-defense? And can you talk a little bit about what that procedure was like?
First of all, could you repeat the first question? Sorry.
Sure. Did you find the girls, the participants, through an organization?
Not really. What we did is, since we have different districts in Bangladesh, we targeted many different districts that were in the rural side. So not the urban areas. So what we did is we talked to our alumni who were from different places like Khulna, Joshur, Rangpur, Ghazipur, and we started looking for schools. And whichever school we could get, we would send them a letter and we would ask them if they were willing to participate, if they were willing to send in two students. And whoever were willing to do that, we would take them in and we would talk to them. And that was the procedure for inviting those girls in. And for self-defense, we had trainers. They have an organization where they teach self-defense. So we brought in around 4 trainers and 2 mentors, a police officer the first time. The police officer talked about road safety and how to take care of yourself or how to defend yourself when it comes to difficult situations. And we brought in trainers who were female and males. They were given by the organization. So you can look for organizations or companies that have these kind of services and ask them. You can either ask them to sponsor or just to do it because you are an organization, a nonprofit organization, and you are doing free of cost. So you show them that incentive and they will be willing to do it. At the end of the day, we are all humans helping each other.
Exactly. I totally agree with that, Tasneem. And it takes a lot of guts. You have to overcome that in order for you to get these things. You think it's very important that we practice maybe communicating. If you kind of have a hard time going to organizations or nonprofits to help with these, with getting these sponsorships, you can always practice on a friend, but you do have to overcome that fear if you want to get that. So that's amazing.
One more thing I would like to add with this is that always remember there's this thing called Memorandum of Understanding, the MOUs. You can use those. Those are like contracts between mentors or trainers that you can make them sign. So over there, you have all the details that are needed from them and you will be providing and what the project is about. So through that, you can have a verified and certified way of getting those trainers in the project.
That's a great tip. Thank you, Tasneem. That's a great tip.
We also see Christine is asking, for any of the other attendees in the chat room, do you have any ideas for projects related to this topic? You know, if you attended and you're suddenly inspired, I know in the poll earlier, there were a lot of people who said they haven't done a project about girls and women yet, but it's on their calendar. It's coming up. So if anyone has any other ideas. Another question that I have personally, Portia and Orpa, I was wondering, what are some ways that you have seen or evaluated the impact of your project? Like, you do the project, but sometimes it's hard to know if you are reaching the results that you're aiming for. So could you share a little bit about that?
Portia, go first.
Okay. After meeting with my girls, we set another day to meet and see how these girls are, you know, using the materials to check on them and see how they are keeping it clean and neat. So I told them, I let them know that the next time I visit them and they are not kept in the way I taught them, then it means they are not going to get a set of kits. So upon hearing that, everybody, you know, is eager to maintain it well and keep it well until I meet them the next time to also check on them. So I think, you know, after having the project with them, also going back to see how, ask from them, to know from them how they are still using it after you meeting with them the first time, how it's going from there. And if there are necessary corrections or anything you have to add to, or anything, you know, any ideas that have come that you can also help in that way, then yes, you can also, you know, go ahead and do that for them. So in few days or few weeks to come, I'm going to meet with my girls again and we are going to go over what we learned and what we discussed and how they are keeping, you know, all these materials. So yeah.
So after the completion of the workshop, the students were asked to go back to their communities and they were given a period of 2 or 3 months to do a project of their own and implement it practically. And they were asked to give us pictures and videos of what they did. And we have documents of all of those things that they did. So there were girls who did cultural programs. There were girls who had done workshops in their own schools. There were girls who opened clubs, actual women empowering clubs in their own schools. And they gave us pictures every now and then. And since we had mentors for every two set of girls, the mentors were always connected to the girls through the phone numbers, and they always talked to each other. They gave advices on how to implement those projects or how to keep the club going or what are the things that are needed. And we do have our core team who from where there is Marianne Kormakar, who is associated with every single one of those girls. So she talks to them, she talks to their parents, she talks to them about how further they have gone or what are the things they're doing or what are the projects they'll be doing in the future. So this is how the ripple effect actually happened, that they started doing projects on their own in their own local community without us being there in the first place.
That's great. It sounds like not only are you too skilled at implementing your projects, you know already about how to evaluate them and then follow up repeatedly.
Which is important. It's important.
Yeah.
And then we see, I'm sorry. I was just going to say Maxim is actually going to be doing a great project in his community. He wants to instill more confidence in girls, and he's thinking about actually doing this in the workforce. So convincing girls that they can do any job of any kind, which is awesome. Great job, Maxim.
Exciting.
Yeah.
This is great. So unfortunately, we have run out of time, although we could talk about this forever. But ladies, if you would like to share maybe an email address or some kind of contact where our participants could reach out to you, it looks like they do have a lot of questions and ideas for implementing similar projects in their community. And I feel like both of you would be excellent resources and mm-hmm. mentors.
Yes.
You can add me on Facebook. I'll give the name, give my name over there on the chat box, and I will also include my email address with it. So.
Wonderful.
So I'm also including my email address in the chat box, and I'm also on Facebook, Oshaya Boar. You can send me a friend request, and I'm always ready to reply to your messages.
That's great. Awesome. Thank you, ladies.
Ladies, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedules to be with us this morning, well, this evening where you are, or afternoon. And for sharing everything that you're doing. And I really hope everyone who joined today is extremely motivated to get ready for Day of the Girl and to be a part of this movement called SDG5. I know I am. Are you motivated, Gloria?
I'm excited.
I'm excited for this. Yeah. I'm excited for October 11th. So thanks so much, everyone, for joining.
Yes, you can also go to the YES website at yesprograms.org to read more stories about these projects and other similar projects that are going on throughout the YES community. You can also find us on Facebook, Youth Exchange and Study, where we are live right now. Hello, everybody.
Hi, everyone that's live. Thank you for joining.
We're on Instagram at yes.program and on Twitter at yesprogramnews. Find the recording on the website, stay in touch, and we hope to see more story submissions about all the other projects that will just sprout from this webinar.
Yes, thank you everyone, and enjoy the rest of your day or evening.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Anna. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Gloria.